Our node name errors are done, so all that's left now is to do the same for our groups. Thankfully, we don't really have nested groups, so we only need to care about groups having the same name. We'll start by creating our error data script, which will hold the color data and the list of groups. So go to our data error folder and create a new C# script which I'll name DSGroupErrorData. Inside, remove the default methods and remove the monobehavior inheritance. I'll make it part of the data.error subnamespace. As variables, we'll have a property of type DSErrorData, to which I'll name ErrorData, and a property of type list of groups, to which I'll name groups. Make sure you import the group class namespace. Much like in our node error data script, we'll have a constructor that will initialize both variables. So error data equals new DS error data, and groups equals new list of groups. We now have our error script done, but if you remember from our nodes, we'll be needing the methods to set the error styles, as well as a variable to hold the default colors. But we cannot do that right now, as we are using the GraphView built-in group class to instantiate our groups. So, to be able to do those things, we'll need to create our own group class that inherits from the GraphView group class. Let's do that by going into our Helmans folder and create a new C# script which I'll name DSGroup. Inside, we'll be removing the default methods and swap the monobehavior inheritance with group, importing the necessary namespace. I'll make it part of the element subnamespace. We can now create our variables. So let's start with our default color, which in here will actually update the border color and not the background color. So type in private color default border color. We'll also update the border width to be thicker, so let's save the default border width by creating a variable of type float and naming it default border width. Next, we'll need to assign their values in the class constructor, so create it by typing in public dsgroup, and inside we'll assign their default values using the style variable. So default border color equals content container dot style dot border bottom color. And this returns a style color, so we need to type in dot value, which returns the actual color value. For our border width, we type in default border width equals content container dot style dot border bottom width dot value, as it returns a style float. We are getting the bottom color and width because that's all we are going to be updating. Much like in our node, we'll now be needing two methods to both set and reset the styles. So type in public void setErrorStyle and we'll be accepting a color here to which I'll name color. We are going to set the content container.style.border.bottomColor to be of the color we've just passed in. We'll also update the content container.style.border.bottomWidth to v2f, which is something that I've placed and liked, so feel free to later on try it around and see what you like the most. Now we only need to create our reset style method, so type in public void reset style, and inside we'll set both to the default values, so copy the code above and simply swap the values to be default border color and then default border width. In our GraphView create group method, we are setting the title and position of the group that we send in, so we can also accept both of those in our constructor and simply set it there. So in our constructor, accept a new parameter of type string, to which I'll name group title, and another one of type vector2, to which I'll name position. Then we simply say the title equals to the passed in group title, and call the setPosition method in which we need to pass in a new rect, with the position as the first parameter and the size of vector2.0 as a second, as it doesn't seem to do anything. We now have our DSGroup script, so the next thing we need to do is to swap every group we use with this new class. We'll be updating it in the following places: the CreateGroup method, the AddGroupNode method, the OnGroupElementsAdded method, the DSNode script, the GroupErrorData script, and the SearchWindow script. So let's first go to our CreateGroup method in our GraphQL script and swap our group with DSGroup instead. We can also remove the ObjectInitializer and the SetPosition method and just call in our constructor with the title and position we want as parameters. Now go to the AddGroupNode method and swap its group with DSGroup instead. Next, go to our OnGroupElementsAdded method and create a new variable above our node of type DSGroup, to which I'll name NodeGroup and assign the callback group to it, casting it into DSGroup and swapping it with the oldGroup variable. Then we'll go to our DSNode script and swap our group variable type to be DSGroup, making sure we also update it in our dialogName text field callback. Once that's done, go to our DSGroupErrorData script and swap the group with DSGroup instead, importing the elements of namespace. Next, let's go to our SearchWindow script and swap our group variable type in the switch case to be DSGroup instead. We don't really need to swap the rest as they are only there to know if we want a group or something else. We are now using our DSGroup class everywhere, so let's now create our groups dictionary. Back to our GraphQL script, create a new private variable of type serializable dictionary, or dictionary if you've been using it this far, and this will be like our ungrouped nodes but with DSGroup error data instead. So type in string for the key type, as they will be the group names, and DSGroup error data for the value type, as it will contain the list of groups with that name. I'll name it groups. Of course, don't forget to initialize the dictionary in our constructor. You'll need to do two things for now: add a group and remove a group, much like our other dictionaries. Let's do that by going to our CreateGroup method and call in a new method we'll be creating named AddGroup. Of course, to add a group, we'll need to pass in the group as a parameter, which we have above. We'll be moving this method to our repeated elements region. In here, we'll do what we did in our ungroupNodesAdd method, but for our groups instead. If the groups dictionary doesn't contain a key with a group name, we simply add in a new element with it. If it does, we simply add that group to the existing element list and update its error styles. Remember that if the count is 2, we need to swap the first group error styles as well. So let's start by creating a new string, to which I'll name groupName, and assign the value of group.title. Next, type in if groups.containsKey of group name, and we'll actually do the does not contain, so type in the not operator at the beginning. Then we'll need to create a new element. For that, we create our DSGroupErrorData, to which I'll name groupErrorData, and add our group into its groups list. Then we simply add our dictionary element into the groups dictionary by typing in groups.add and passing the group name as a key and the group error data variable as a value. At the end, simply return. We now need to add our group to the already existing list if the previous if check statement is false. We can of course do that very easily by typing in groups at the key of group name dot groups dot add and pass in our group. All that's left is to add the color error to this group and the first group when the group's list count is equal to 2. So create a variable of type color to which I'll name error color and assign the value of groups at group name dot error data dot color. Then set its error styles by typing in group.setErrorStyle and pass in our error color variable. We'll be using the groups list again, so let's create a variable above of type list of DSGroup, which shall name groups list and initialize it with groups at groupName.groups. Then swap it right under. Next, we'll add the error style when the count of list is 2, so type in if groupsList.count equals equals 2. We get the first element of the list by typing in groupsList at the index position of 0 dot set error style and pass in our error color variable. And that's our add method done. If we save and go to Unity, adding multiple groups should lead to their color changing. Of course, if we delete them, they will still be showing the error. Although we can't delete them yet because our group deletion is not working, as we haven't done it in our override delete selection callback. That's because we don't yet have our remove group method. We'll be using this method in only one place, and that's when we select a group and delete it using the delete key or the delete contextual menu. Therefore, it will be in our delete selection callback. So let's go to our callback and start it out by creating a variable of type type, to which I'll name group type, and give it the value of type of DSGroup. Then in our for each loop, we'll have an if check statement that will check if the type of the element is of type DSGroup. So type in if element.getType is different than group type. If this is true, we simply continue to the next element. Otherwise, we create a new variable of type DSGroup, to which I'll name group, and cast our element into this type. Then we can simply call a method we'll create named RemoveGroup, in which we pass in our group into it. Before updating our method though, let's make sure we are deleting our groups from the graph view, as it no longer does it automatically for us. To do that, we'll be adding each group to a list, simply because we shouldn't be updating the list we are iterating through right now. So above, create a list of DSGroup, to which I'll name groups to delete and initialize it. After we remove our group from our dictionary, we'll simply add it into this list by typing in groupsToDelete.add and pass in our group. Then after our loop, we'll make another one, much like our nodes loop, but for our groups. So type in for each DSGroup group in groupsToDelete, and inside simply type in removeElement and pass in the group. We can now delete our groups with our delete button or delete contextual menu. Though make sure you have placed this for each on top of the nodes one, because later on this order will be important. Now back to our remove group method, what we'll do is again the same as our remove and group node method. We'll start by removing the group from the list, so create a new string to which I'll name group name and set it to group.title. Then type in groups at groupName.groups.remove and pass in our group. When that's done, simply reset its error styles by typing in group.resetStyle. We'll be using the groups list multiple times, so create a new list above of type DSGroup, to which I'll name groupsList, and assign the groups at the key of groupName.groupsList into it. Then swap it right under. After that, we'll check if the groups list only has one group left, so to remove its error style. So type in if groupsList.count equals equals 1, reset its styles by typing in groupsList at the index of 0.resetStyle. Then we'll remove the element if the groups list count is 0, as that means there are no more groups with that name left. So type in if groupsList.count equals equals 0, and inside type in groups.remove and pass in the group name. Feel free to return on the above if you prefer. Saving and going back to Unity, we shall now be able to add and delete and have no problems doing that. There is still one slight problem though, and that's updating their names. If we do that, there is nothing telling us to remove the group and add it in again. And if we think of it, we don't really have our own text field that allows us to add our own callback. Thankfully for us, Unity provides us with two ways of doing that. At least, I think one of them is also on purpose for us to override it, but I'm not entirely sure. The first one is overriding a method called onGroupRenamed. This method gets the new and the old title and allows you to do what you want with it. Seeing the base method in GitHub brings to an empty implementation in the group class, so I'm not entirely sure if it is for us to override or not, simply because they also have the second option. The group title changed callback. This is great because we can take care of it in our GraphQL script together with the other callbacks. The problem, however, is that for some reason Unity decided to return the group in the callback together with the new title, discarding the old title. And that's a problem because we are able to get a new title through the group.title variable, but we don't really have a provided way of obtaining the old title, so we can't really remove the old group from the dictionary. I'm not entirely sure which one should we be using, but I decided to go with the callback just because we've been using the callbacks until now. For the old title, we'll have to do it ourselves. The way we'll be doing it might be a bit confusing at first, so I'll try to explain it. Whenever we initialize a group, we'll be setting both the current and the old title to be equal. Then, when removing the group, we'll be removing it using the old title and not the current title. This is so that we can remove the element with the old name, because by the time we call our removeGroup method, the group will already have the new name, which is the one we want to add in and not remove. Of course, once we are done removing it, we can update the old title variable to hold the current title again, so as to remove it correctly next time as well, and simply add in our group at the end using the AddGroup method, which can stay as is even though it will be fine to use the old title by now. So let's go to our DSGroup script and create a new public variable of type string, to which I'll name oldTitle. Then in our constructor we simply set it to be groupTitle, much like our title provided variable. Back to our graph view. We'll start by creating a new callback method named onGroupRenamed in our callback region under every other method. So type in private void onGroupRenamed, and inside we'll be setting the group title change callback, which accepts both a group and a new title. This group is of course a GraphView group, so we need to cast it to our DSGroup class. To do that, create a variable of type DSGroup, which I'll name DSGroup, and cast the group variable. Once that's done, call the removeGroup method and pass in DSGroup. Of course, we need to update our removeGroup method to use the oldTitle instead. So in the group name variable, change the title to oldTitle, and also update the group name variable to be named oldGroupName, if you prefer that. Back to our callback, we can now update the group old title to be equal to the new title. So type in dsgroup.oldTitle equals to new title. This will make it so that next time we remove the group, it will remove the element with the current name and not the one we've already removed. Then we simply add in the group again using the addGroup method and passing in our dsgroup variable. Of course, for this callback to be overrided, we need to call this method in our constructor. So let's do that. Saving up, we shall now have our group name errors working as they should.